In the late 1960s, drug addiction in the American cities was on the increase, and crime was rising. The government was forced to take action. In 1971, President Nixon declared war on drugs. Just a year later, law enforcement won a major battle by breaking up the Marseille-based heroin racket known as the French Connection. These French laboratories were supplying America with so much of the drug that the bust led to a heroin famine on the streets. What nobody knew was that this success would lead to disaster. Shutting down the French Connection was indirectly opening the door to something every bit as dangerous, the Sicilian Mafia. In the coming years, they would fill the gap in the market and forge a relationship with the most feared mafioso in America, Carmine Galante. In 1974, 2 years after the French Connection was busted, Carmine Galante walked out of prison, ready to flood America with a new source of heroin and turn the Mafia into a global drugs corporation. Galante was a member of the Mafia family known as the Bananos. He had a long history of drug trafficking and an even longer history as a tough guy. His personality could be summed up by an incident at Lewisburg Prison, where he was serving a sentence for drugs trafficking.
During telephone days, when inmates line up to use the telephone, he was in a section which had some of the toughest black inmates you've ever seen, murderers, strong-arm artists, you name it. And he would simply walk to the head of the line, grab the phone out of some black inmate's hand and said, "Get off the phone, this surrounded by 200 black guys." No one dared touch a hair on his head.
When he got out of prison, the rumblings that, you know, that you heard on the street, was a lot of people were scared of him. And he was a real tough guy, little office rocker, and always known as a heroin man. That's what he did.
When Galante got out of prison, the Bananos were in crisis, their leadership either exiled or in prison. Joe Bonanno's son, Bill, is a convicted mobster. He remembers Galante only too well.
He had a short fuse. He was abrasive. He had a manner about him that he would never win any popularity contest, and constantly had a cigar in his mouth. And that's where he got his nickname, the cigar.
With no challengers prepared to take on this dangerous man, the Bananos had their new boss. Galante's top priority was to kickstart the heroin trade. In 5 short years, he transformed the fortunes of the US Mafia by leading it into an era of multi-billion dollar profits and unparalleled violence.
In the 70s, the Bonanno family was known in the Mafia circles basically as being the heroin family. I mean, you know, everybody knew they were dealing in heroin.
Galante was now in the perfect position to build a heroin business even bigger than the French Connection. He was head of the Bonanno family, and now the heroin trade was moving to Sicily, where Galante had his roots. Galante was born in New York, but his family came from the town of Castellammare del Golfo in the northwest of Sicily. Sicilians had been emigrating to America for 100 years, but many of their descendants kept strong links with their homeland. Galante was no exception. His plan was to exploit his close ties with the Sicilian Mafia to dominate the American heroin trade. This was the beginning of a whole new era in the history of the Mafia. Until now, the Sicilian and American Mafia had mainly operated as separate organizations. With the French connection broken, the Sicilian mafia decided to fill the gap in the market. And there was no bigger market than America. The Sicilians set up a sophisticated smuggling system. Pakistani suppliers shipped partially refined opium from Asia via Turkey to a rendezvous point off the coast of Sicily. A transmitter on the seabed alerted the Sicilians when the drug ships had arrived. Then a powerboat would speed out to meet it, returning with the drugs under cover of darkness. The opium base was processed into heroin in laboratories on the west of the island. Three Sicilian bosses ran this growing trade, but one of them was far more ambitious, far more greedy, and far more dangerous than the others. Totò Riina. Riina planned to shake up the Sicilian mafia, just as Galante was making waves in America. The Sicilian mafia always claimed they adhered to a code of honor, murdering only when necessary, and avoiding the killing of innocents, women and children. But Riina shunned these old guard rules. Riina was as ambitious as he was ruthless. He was determined to become the boss of bosses, head of the Sicilian mafia. To achieve this, he would commit so many atrocities that he became known simply as the Beast. Totò Riina, known as the Beast, was putting Sicily on the heroin map. In the early 70s, his factories were producing ton after ton of pure heroin. All of it needed to be sold. On the other side of the Atlantic, Carmine Galante and the American mafia could see that there were huge sums to be made selling Sicilian heroin. But there was also a problem. Throughout its history, the US mafia had vowed never to be associated with drugs. The Chicago mob, known as the Outfit, was one of the most vocal opponents of the drugs trade.
We always knew that if you dealt with drugs, it was a dirty business. And it'd be like you're feeding your own kid narcotics. So it was like taboo. And if you got involved with it, you're definitely gonna get whacked.
As far as the Outfit was concerned, there was no need to deal drugs when money could be made in more acceptable ways. In the 1970s, Frank Carlotta was sent to Las Vegas to make sure nobody messed with the Outfit's highly profitable casinos.
My main job was the casinos, to make sure that everything ran smooth in there, there was no stealing going on, that they knew that our presence was there, that if they did mess around, that they would get hit in the head.
For Carlotta and his crew, running casinos earned them respect in a way drugs never would.
Actually, it was great. It was beautiful. I mean, you had everything you needed out here. You had anything you wanted to do. You movie stars. You wanted to be. They wanted to be involved with you. You wanted to be involved with them. Anywhere you went, you got the red carpet treatment. It was like. You were respected. I think you were respected. I'm hoping that I wasn't feared, but in some cases you were feared. And if that brought respect, well, then it brought respect.
But for others, the huge profits of heroin dealing were hard to resist. From his beginnings in suburban Brooklyn, Dominic Montilio grew up to be a member of the notorious New York crime family, the Gambinos. He dealt drugs for the mafia for many years.
The word that filtered down, just saying, you know, if you got caught, you know, dealing drugs, you know, it was an immediate death sentence. But the real message that came down was just don't get caught. At that time, I couldn't think of one crew that I knew that wasn't involved in it, because the money was too lucrative to pass up. The street crews that were involved in it weren't going to give it up either which way. You know, there was guys that weren't making a real good living that all of a sudden were taking, you know, 150 large a week down.
The mob didn't want to be seen to be peddling drugs, but they were happy to take the money.
I mean, the reason, there was no great moral reasons why they didn't want you dealing in heroin. It was just that it would bring that much more heat on the family. But the bottom line is the cash, you know, and that's a cash business. And the amounts are staggering, the amounts of money that can be made.
The New York families knew that dealing drugs would attract attention from the authorities, but it was a risk they were prepared to take. The U.S. Mafia secretly embraced the heroin trade and were soon making more money than they knew what to do with.
The unpleasant fact is that there is a new epidemic of heroin use in the United States.
As Sicilian heroin began to flow, addiction rates in America soared. At the end of World War II, America had an estimated 20,000 heroin users. By the mid-70s, there were more than 500,000. The FBI had little idea how such large quantities of drugs were getting into the country, or who was bringing it in. But that was about to change. In the 50s and 60s, FBI agents were mostly white males. Now the FBI was recruiting from a much wider pool. Finally, they had young, ambitious agents who came from the communities that were home to the Mafia and could speak the Sicilian dialect. Joe Pistone was a young FBI agent from a Sicilian background. His mission was to infiltrate the Mafia, something that had never been done before.
I grew up in New Jersey, and I grew up in an Italian neighborhood. And in this neighborhood, there were mafia guys, mob guys, and I went to high school with sons of mob guys. So I knew about the mafia growing up. It wasn't foreign to me when I became an FBI agent. So I was pretty well versed in the ways and traditions of the mafia.
Joe Pistone's dream was always to be a cop.
Growing up, it was easy. It would have been easy to go, you know, to go crooked or become bent because you're in the neighborhood. You see what's going on. There are guys doing illegal activities, but I never had an inkling to go toward that because of my parents. I mean, I know if I ever did anything wrong, that I get a good swift boot in the rear end from my father.
On July the 7th, 1969, Pistone was sworn in as a special agent of the FBI. 7 years later, he disappeared from everyday life and developed a new identity.
Everybody needs a legend, and that's a history, a legend of history. And so, you know, you pick a name, and I picked Donnie Brasco, and I picked a jewel thief, burglar, jewel thief, because it's a profession that is not involved in violence. You know, not many jewel thieves are in jail for murder. So you want a legend that is a non-violent legend, and you want one where you can provide somebody with something. So I could come around with precious gems, jewels, and tell them that I had just pulled a score.
Pistone's job was to work his way into a mafia family. The risks were great, but if he pulled it off, he had the chance to expose a secret world of crime. One wrong move, and he faced almost certain death.
In order to do this job, undercover work, you have to have two things. You gotta have a lot of nerve, and you gotta have a lot of mental toughness. I'm not a person that sweats, you know? When I get into a jam, I don't sweat, so you don't know if you're scaring me or not, you know? And, you know, there's not much that can be done to you. The worst thing that can happen is they can kill you. That's about it.
The FBI wanted the inside story on the Mafia. The Banano boss, Carmine Galante, was their first target. Pistone used the FBI's diamonds and his Sicilian roots to gradually infiltrate Galante's Mafia family.
being of Italian ancestry and knowing the streets and knowing how the mafia operates, you know, you speak when you're spoken to. You mind your own business. You don't get involved in conversations that don't concern you. They don't just, you know, embrace you and take you in. And you have to just lay back, be patient, and work your way. You know, and it's the first impression that's gonna carry you through. And if you do things, certain things that they pick you out, that you have street smarts and you are a street guy, that's what's gonna make you.
In March 1977, Pistone began to hang around in known Bonanno territory. He soon got noticed by mafia foot soldiers. One of the wise guys Pistone met was Lefty Ruggiero. Pistone would later discover that Lefty was a known hitman for the mob. Lefty approached Pistone, asking him to sell some stolen jewelry.
I was introduced to a fellow by the name of Lefty Ruggiero, and Lefty was a 24-hour gangster. I mean, he knew the mob, he knew everything about the mafia. If you need a teacher in the mafia, Lefty was the guy that you wanted. I used my street smarts and my knowledge of the mafia, and I didn't push with him as far as questions and, you know, trying to get the information. And he liked that. He saw that I was a street guy, that I knew the streets. And also, you know, being a jewel thief, and bringing around some precious stones. He liked that too, because it was money, you know.
As his undercover operation stretched into months and years, Pistone gradually became an accepted face within the mob. But the risks remained high. Former gangster Henry Hill knows all about the dangers that Pistone faced.
I mean, he was susceptible to get figured out at any time, you know? I mean, it took balls. Believe me, it took balls. But he also enjoyed it. You know, he became a member. Or as close as you can come as a member.
Pistone was so convincing, an almost father and son relationship developed between him and Lefty.
He did have an affection for me, I think, because he saw me, you know, something that he might have wanted to have been, or his son, you know, to have been. And he introduced me to his family and his wife, and I spent a lot of times at his house having dinner. So it became more than just a, you know, gangster on gangster relationship.
By the summer of 1977, Pistone had won Lefty's trust. But would he ever get any closer to heroin boss Carmine Galante?
I was with Lefty one night, and he said, we gotta go somewhere. And I said, well, where we're going? And he said, well, I'll tell you when we get there. Galante was having a meeting in there, and it was our job to stand outside and make sure that the meeting went smooth and nothing happened. Basically, we were outside guarding them.
This was a big opportunity for Pistone.
And I asked him, I said, you know, Left, can't we go inside? And he says, what are you, crazy? You can't go in there and sit down when the boss is meeting. You can't even meet the boss. You know, he doesn't meet anybody on your level. He says, we got to stand out here until we're told till they release us, till we can go. You know, it was kind of an adrenaline rush. A lot of things go through your mind, but the main thing was is that if I get killed, I'm going to get killed as a wise guy, not as an FBI agent here. You know, here I'm an FBI agent working undercover, and, you know, nobody ever got to be close to a boss, let alone guard him.
Pistone did not get as close to Galante as he wanted, but he learned important facts about his operation. Before Pistone went undercover, the FBI had some idea about the inner workings of the mob. Now, for the first time, an agent was able to confirm the way the Mafia was organized from the inside. Pistone told the FBI how each family was structured into a military formation. At the top was the head of the family. Working directly for him was an underboss and an advisor, known as a consigliere. Beneath them were the capos, each of whom ran a crew of 5 to 10 foot soldiers. This structure meant the boss was always several layers away from the foot soldiers and the crimes they committed, making it almost impossible to convict the head of the family. This was vital intelligence in the war against the mob, but it was just the beginning. Pistone also managed to find out the secret of Galante's meteoric rise within the New York Mafia.
Joe came back to us telling us about Sicilians whom the American mafia figures were referring to as Zips. And to him, this meant that these Sicilian mafia figures within the Bonanno family were actually being used to commit murder, dealing in drugs, heroin. That was a just unbelievable revelation.
I met some Sicilian that were members of the mafia. These guys were made guys over in Sicily and then brought over here. But the Sicilians had their own clique over here in the U.S.
Galante had imported his own private army of ruthless Sicilian mafiosi.
Galante's two key guys that he brought over were Cesar Bonaventure and Baldo Amato. He brought them over from Sicily, and they were with him constantly. And I think one of the reasons why he did bring him over is that he felt a better sense of security with the Sicilians, because I guess he felt they were still loyal to the tradition. They weren't Americanized yet.
Galante's new bodyguards made waves in the Bonanno family.
There was a lot of friction I found between the American mafia and the Sicilians, even though they were married up into one family. I mean, anyway, Lefty and Sonny and the other Americans thought that they were looking to take over the family, and that the other American mafia guys didn't trust them and didn't like them.
The Sicilian and American mafia were cut from very different cloth. In the past, the Sicilians had embraced rules and traditions, but that was changing.
They'd kill anyone, you know, where we had certain rules. You know, it sounds strange, but there were rules as to, you know, who you had to get permission from to go do a piece of work, or you couldn't kill a guy in front of his family, and, you know, they didn't have those rules.
These new ruthless Sicilians were from a mafia clan based in Corleone, a remote rural town deep in the mountains of Sicily.
Corleone mafiosi are made of different stuff. They're tough, very hard. Probably their peasant lifestyle trained them to withstand anything thrown at them. Jail doesn't scare the Corleonesi. They aren't frightened of death. They're always faithful to their boss.
The Corleonesi had reached the top of the Sicilian mafia by breaking rules and killing without permission from anyone. In the American mafia, obedience to your superiors was deeply ingrained. The godfather of the American mafia, Charlie Lucky Luciano, had formed an organization known as the Commission back in 1931. This was like the board of directors of the mafia. All the heads of the families would meet to settle disputes and decide on strategy. The commission imposed discipline on the warring families. Rules were agreed, which changed little over decades. One of the rules was that you didn't kill someone without permission from the head of your family. Las Vegas mobster Frank Carlotta nearly paid the ultimate price when this rule was broken, thanks to his ruthless boss, Tony Spilotro.
I grew up with this Tony guy. He was a very good friend. And as I said, you know, very good friends are the ones that are going to get you killed. And when he had ordered me to whack some guy out here, I asked him, did you get the okay from back home? And he said, yeah. And he promised me he did. Well, he never did get the okay from home. And he got a call from one of the bosses back there, and they said, what are you guys doing out there?
Killing someone without authorization from Chicago was breaking the rules. The punishment was death. Tony Spilotro decided to blame his best friend, Frank Carlotta.
He was lying. He was taking the weight off himself because he knew that if he didn't, and said he readily ordered me to do these things, that they would whack him in the head. So he shifted everything over to me. That was my best friend. We shined shoes together when we were 12, 13 years old. So all my life. He's the guy that actually was the guy that told me, when I get to be a big man, you're my right-hand man. And I was. But that's the same guy that was gonna sell me out to save his ass and get me whacked.
It wasn't long before Tony Spilotro and his mobster brother received deadly punishment at the hands of the mob.
Believe it or not, I felt a little bad for him. Because they were both beaten to death. They weren't shot, they weren't strangled, they weren't knifed. They were physically punched to death, or beaten with bats to death, however, you know. And each one was to watch one die, you know. So I felt bad. There were two brothers, same time. I grew up with the guy. Even though the guy tried to kill me, I still felt bad.
For all American mafiosi, the rules of the commission were a fact of life and death.
You really never know who to trust. I don't care how close you are with him, if you grew up with him or what. That's going to be the one that's going to kill you, usually. It's your best friend.
Carmine Galante didn't care about the commission or its rules. He believed the American mafia was soft and that his connections with the ruthless Sicilians made him invincible. But there was more than one advantage of having an alliance with the old country.
At first, nobody thought much about it. But then the rest of the mafia began to get really nervous because they began to ask themselves, now, why is he bringing in so many of these Zips? And everybody put two and two together. These guys are running heroin. This is a Sicilian connection at work here. We don't need this. For one thing, the organization felt, we can't control the Zips.
Sicilians made and smuggled in the heroin. By hiring them into his own crew, Galante was making sure he would stay at the heart of the heroin business.
For what he was trying to do with in the heroin business, it would have been, you know, good for him to be aligned with the more Sicilians the better, because that's where the pipeline came from.
In the late 70s, the Sicilian mafia dominated the heroin trade. On the streets of America, the profits being made were reaching $20 billion a year. Galante was trying to keep the profits to himself. Something had to be done.
He was greedy. He wasn't, the Bananos may have been involved in this, the profits from this drug trade, but Galante wasn't sharing it even with his own people and the family. Because he was, and nobody was going to tell him what to do, and he was going to run his family, and he wanted to run the other families too. And during this time, Galante was making deadly enemies. The other bosses didn't like him because of this attitude that he had, that he was the top boss in the city.
Everyone knew on the street that the clouds of war were right there. I mean, if this guy stayed loose, what he was plotting would have definitely caused major, major, you know, war to happen between the families.
For mob bosses, the Galante problem was growing. Only the commission had the authority to act. Their solution would be violent. Galante had to go. On July the 12th, 1979, Carmine Galante paid a visit to Joe and Mary's restaurant on Knickerbocker Avenue in Brooklyn. It was one of his favorite haunts. Run by his cousin, he felt safe there. He was joined by his two loyal Sicilian bodyguards.
There's a courtyard that you go into, and is an open-air courtyard. And they were sitting down having, getting ready to have lunch. And Galante was sitting there, and he had his cigar in his mouth. Three guys pull up outside, jump out of a car. They run in the restaurant and start blasting away. Galante ends up getting shot, falls off his chair, sprawls out on the ground, face up, and he still has his cigar clenched in his mouth. And that's how they got Galante.
This is the famous front page that greeted America the next morning. Galante's meteoric rise to the top had ended in a pool of blood.
Carmine Galante was rubbed out today as he sat in a Brooklyn luncheonette, a gangland execution of a man believed to be the most important organized crime figure in the country.
After the murder, the killers fled the scene. But in an amazing coincidence, one of them walked into a club that was under police surveillance. This incredible footage shows him reporting back to the commission bosses after the successful hit. But the feds were about to get an even bigger surprise.
Well, when the police came on the scene, they had immediately identified Carmine Galante's body. He was an old man, had a cigar stuck in his mouth, totally lifeless. As the police pieced everything together, they were told that two other individuals who were in the backyard with Galante, later identified as his so-called bodyguards, they were the ones who miraculously got out of there without any wounds whatsoever.
The forensics found five different caliber slugs in Galante, and there were only three gunmen. So that leads you to believe that there were two guns someplace else, and the only other two guys there were Bonaventure and Amato.
Bonaventure and Amato were the two key Sicilians Galante had brought over for his own protection.
The police deduced from what they saw at the scene that Bonaventure and Amato were not there to protect Galante. They were there to ensure that his assassination was carried out without a hitch. The ultimate treachery was performed by his own men. The men who were supposed to protect him from any harm, they were the ones who actually helped carry out the assassination.
The Sicilians had turned on Galante. It seemed his greed had upset others besides the commission.
The Sicilians who had arrived in America in the 60s and 70s, who were helping bring in the heroin from Sicily, wanted full control in their hands. The message was, we are bringing it in, we are going to be involved in the distribution network. Therefore, we want a bigger share in the proceeds. And that was the message of the new Sicilians. We are the ones doing it, we want a bigger share. Not what Galante was doing, keeping most of the share for himself.
Galante's murder made the FBI even more suspicious about the Bonanno family. For the commission to whack a boss meant there were big things going on. Two young agents, Charlie Rooney and Carmine Russo, were given the job of watching the Bonanno Sicilians.
This is the area where myself and my partner Charlie Rooney spent a lot of time conducting surveillance. And we needed to find intelligence that could only be found on the street. And that meant being out here, being the eyes and ears, basically, of the FBI, trying to determine who these Sicilians were and what they were doing.
One Bonanno member, who soon came to their attention, was Sal Catalano, who ran an Italian bakery in Queens. The FBI realized that Catalano was a key figure in the heroin trade. Suspicious packages were constantly being exchanged, probably containing either heroin or money. The FBI decided to play a waiting game in the hope they could break open the whole operation.
One of the things that we in the FBI, and of course all of law enforcement, wanted to know was how were they bringing the heroin into the United States at that time?
Over the next 5 years, Russo and Rooney's surveillance operation evolved into the largest investigation the FBI had ever undertaken. Finally, after recording and translating more than 55,000 wiretaps, the team of 400 agents worked out how the Mafia smuggled heroin into America.
They used their businesses, furniture businesses, construction businesses, marble, things of that nature. In particular, the pizzeria business. They needed tomatoes for the sauce.
The Mafia had taken over pizzerias across the country and given them to immigrant Sicilians to manage. The operation was controlled by Sal Catalano from his bakery in Queens. This footage shows some of the actual restaurants implicated in the Pizza Connection trial. Restaurants just like these were used to distribute heroin around the country. The heroin arrived in the US through all kinds of routes. Their methods were often ingenious. Cases of canned tomatoes or boxes of cheese arrived from Sicily, stuffed with heroin worth hundreds of thousands of dollars. But the pizza network was not a retail operation. Mafia dealers never sold the heroin directly on the streets. Instead, the imported narcotics were divided up and sold to smaller street dealers. That way, the bosses stayed well away from the dirty end of the business. The pizza restaurants had another use as well. Catalano and his crew could hide their profits by passing them off as restaurant takings.
Pretty ingenious cover. I mean, you know, who figures a pizza place? You know, you figure you see some guy slinging dough around making a pizza. What's he gonna be involved in?
Mafia dealer Henry Hill regularly used pizza restaurants for his drug drop-offs.
It wasn't difficult for me. I used to go to a pizza joint in a shopping center, leave my car there, and take a different car home, you know? And I go back 4 days later, you know, sit there and put the money in the trunk.
The evidence the FBI found led to the very top of the Mafia and all the way back to Sicily.
Salvatore Catalano was aligned with the Colonnesi in Sicily. That's where the power came from. It was Salvatore Rina, the boss of the Colonnesi. Salvatore Catalano came here with a purpose. Purpose was the Sicilian Mafia had a commodity that was being sent to the United States. They needed people here whom they could trust and carry on that activity.
The power of the Colonnesi Mafia and their ruthless boss, Totore Rina, stretched all the way to America.
Who knows how long they had been doing this before we stumbled onto them. And we basically stumbled onto them. And I believe what did it for them and for us was the Galante murder. Without that murder, I don't think we would have set our eyes on them at the time that we did.
Meanwhile, FBI agent Joe Pistone still had a problem. How to escape alive from his undercover role inside the Mafia. Despite Galante's murder, Joe Pistone's dangerous undercover operation continued for two more years. But in 1981, his mission came to a dramatic climax. The head of Pistone's mafia crew was a hard man called Sonny Black. Over the years, Black had been impressed with Pistone. Now, Sonny decided to honor Pistone by making him a made man, a full member of the mafia. But there was one big catch. Pistone would have to kill someone.
When Sonny Black gave me the contract to do the hit, I mean, you can't refuse it. You have to take the contract, otherwise you're the next guy that's gonna get killed, because, you know, that's just part of being a mob guy, a mafia guy, is that, because you don't do hits on a fee basis. You just do it because you're part of that crew. I accepted the hit. Luckily, the guy that I had the contract on was on the lam because he knew he was going to get killed. But I went looking for him. I went to Florida, back to New York, and couldn't find him because he was in hiding.
In a twist of fate, Pistone was asked to whack one of the men who had assassinated Carmine Galante. But it was not to be.
Hey.
The FBI could not allow an agent to commit murder. On July the 26th, 1981, Pistone was pulled out.
Did the kids ask about me?
The FBI decided to tell Pistone's mafia contacts that he was an undercover agent. Despite Galante's murder, Joe Pistone's dangerous undercover operation continued for two more years. But in 1981, his mission came to a dramatic climax. The head of Pistone's mafia crew was a hard man called Sonny Black. Over the years, Black had been impressed with Pistone. Now, Sonny decided to honor Pistone by making him a made man, a full member of the mafia. But there was one big catch. Pistone would have to kill.
He was in a body bag, and they had chopped off his hands. And that was an indication that he had brought me around to shake hands with mob guys that were of status.
These photos of Lefty were taken just after he found out Pistone was an FBI agent. He knew he was in big trouble. The mafia would never forgive such a mistake. The Bonannos put out a contract on Lefty Ruggiero. But the FBI found out and snatched him into custody before the killers got to him. Pistone gave evidence against Lefty, and he was sentenced to 20 years. He died of cancer on Thanksgiving Day, 1995.
At least Lefty didn't get clipped, you know? He lived his life in jail. He got what he deserved. I mean, you know, I didn't make Lefty a gangster. I didn't make Sonny a gangster. I didn't make any of these guys gangsters. They were gangsters before I got there. They were gangsters while I was there, and they were gangsters after I left.
Joe Pistone had survived undercover for 6 years.
But I mean, you know, that's a long time to spend undercover with that, you know, with a crew that's, you know, more than capable of killing you and taking you apart, you know, dumping your body's parts somewhere. And to have those guys trust you to a point, I mean, I never heard an FBI guy coming close to getting made. You know, I mean, they were looking to make him.
Bullshitted his way through it, and then he got addicted to it. And it took the government a lot of years. And, you know, I mean, they got a lot of cases out of it, but it almost destroyed his life, you know. And he thought he was a wise guy, you know, and he thought he was an FBI agent.
After being pulled out, Pistone spent the next 5 years testifying against his mafia buddies. Then in 1986, he left the FBI to write a book about his experiences. But his life would never be the same again. Even now, he lives under an assumed name, under constant threat of assassination.
The mafia put a contract out on me when the operation terminated and I surfaced. My identity showed up. Am I worried about it? I don't think about it every day. Just take precautions and go about living the way I live. And if it happens, it happens. And
best man will win.
Thanks to the efforts of law enforcement agents like Joe Pistone and Carmine Russo, the Pizza Connection investigation seriously weakened the American Mafia. After years of making vast profits from narcotics, it would take much more than that to stop them. No one could have foreseen that in the coming years, the actions of one Mafia boss would change everything and bring the American and Sicilian Mafia to their knees. had reached the top of the Sicilian Mafia by breaking rules and killing without permission from anyone. In the American Mafia, obedience to your superiors was deeply ingrained. The godfather of the American Mafia, Charlie Lucky Luciano, had formed an organization known as the Commission back in 1931. This was like the board of directors of the Mafia. All the heads of the families would meet to settle disputes and decide on strategy. The Commission imposed discipline on the warring families. Rules were agreed, which changed little over decades. One of the rules was that you didn't kill someone without permission from the head of your family. Las Vegas mobster Frank Carlotta nearly paid the ultimate price when this rule was broken, thanks to his ruthless boss, Tony Spilotro.
I grew up with this Tony guy. He was a very good friend. And as I said, you know, very good friends that are ones that are going to get you killed. And when he had ordered me to whack some guy out here, I asked him, did you get the okay from back home? And he said, yeah. And he promised me he did. Well, he never did get the okay from home. And he got a call from one of the bosses back there, and they said, what are you guys doing out there?
Killing someone without authorization from Chicago was breaking the rules. The punishment was death. Tony Spilotro decided to blame his best friend, Frank Carlotta.
He was lying. He was taking the weight off himself because he knew that if he didn't, and said he readily ordered me to do these things, that they would whack him in the head. So he shifted everything over to me. That was my best friend. We shined shoes together when we were 12, 13 years old. So all my life. He's the guy that actually was the guy that told me, when I get to be a big man, you're my right-hand man. And I was. But that's the same guy that was gonna sell me out to save his ass and get me whacked.
It wasn't long before Tony Spilotro and his mobster brother received deadly punishment at the hands of the mob.
Believe it or not, I felt a little bad for him. Because they were both beaten to death. They weren't shot, they weren't strangled, they were
living the way I live, and if it happens, it happens, and the best man will win.
Thanks to the efforts of law enforcement agents like Joe Pistone and Carmine Russo, the Pizza Connection investigation seriously weakened the American Mafia. After years of making vast profits from narcotics, it would take much more than that to stop them. No one could have foreseen that in the coming years, the actions of one mafia boss would change everything and bring the American and Sicilian mafia to their knees. All of it needed to be sold. On the other side of the Atlantic, Carmine Galante and the American Mafia could see that there were huge sums to be made selling Sicilian heroin. But there was also a problem. Throughout its history, the US Mafia had vowed never to be associated with drugs. The Chicago mob, known as the Outfit, was one of the most vocal opponents of the drugs trade.
We always knew that if you dealt with drugs, it was a dirty business. And it'd be like you're feeding your own kid narcotics. So it was like taboo. And if you got involved with it, you're definitely gonna get whacked.
As far as the Outfit was concerned, there was no need to deal drugs when money could be made in more acceptable ways. In the 1970s, Frank Calotta was sent to Las Vegas to make sure nobody messed with the Outfit's highly profitable casinos.
My main job was the casinos, to make sure that everything ran smooth in there, there was no stealing going on, that they knew that our presence was there, that if they did mess around, that they would get hit in the head.
For Calotta and his crew, running casinos earned them respect in a way drugs never would.
Actually, it was great. It was beautiful. I mean, you had everything you needed out here. You had anything you wanted to do. You movie stars. You wanted to be. They wanted to be involved with you. You wanted to be involved with them. Anywhere you went, you got the red carpet treatment. It was like you were respected. I think you were respected. I'm hoping that I wasn't feared, but in some cases you were feared. And if that brought respect, well, then it brought respect.
But for others, the huge profits of heroin dealing were hard to resist. From his beginnings in suburban Brooklyn, Dominic Montilio grew up to be a member of the notorious New York crime family, the Gambinos. He dealt drugs for the Mafia for many years.
The word that filtered down, just saying, you know, if you got caught, you know, dealing drugs, you know, it was an immediate death sentence. But the real message that came down was just don't get caught. At that time, I couldn't think of one crew that I knew that wasn't involved in it, because the money was too lucrative to pass up. The street crews that were involved in it weren't gonna give it up either which way. You know, there was guys that weren't making a real good living that all of a sudden were taking, you know, 150 large a week down.
Was sent to Las Vegas to make sure nobody messed with the Outfit's highly profitable casinos.
My main job was the casinos, to make sure that everything ran smooth in there, there was no stealing going on, that they knew that our presence was there, that if they did mess around, that they would get hit in the head.
For Calotta and his crew, running casinos earned them respect in a way drugs never would.
Actually, it was great. It was beautiful. I mean, you had everything you needed out here. You had anything you wanted to do. You movie stars. You wanted to be. They wanted to be involved with you. You wanted to be involved with them. Anywhere you went, you got the red carpet treatment. It was like you were respected. I think you were respected. I'm hoping that I wasn't feared, but in some cases you were feared. And if that brought respect, well, then it brought respect.
But for others, the huge profits of heroin dealing were hard to resist. From his beginnings in suburban Brooklyn, Dominic Montilio grew up to be a member of the notorious New York crime family, the Gambinos. He dealt drugs for the Mafia for many years.
The word that filtered down, just saying, you know, if you got caught, you know, dealing drugs, you know, it was an immediate death sentence. But the real message that came down was just don't get caught. At that time, I couldn't think of one crew that I knew that wasn't involved in it, because the money was too lucrative to pass up. The street crews that were involved in it weren't gonna give it up either which way. You know, there was guys that weren't making a real good living that all of a sudden were taking, you know, 150 large a week down.
The mob didn't want to be seen to be peddling drugs, but they were happy to take the money.
I mean, the reason, there was no great moral reasons why they didn't want you dealing in heroin. It was just that it would bring that much more heat on the family. But the bottom line is the cash, you know, and that's a cash business. And the amounts are staggering, the amounts of money that can be made.
The New York families knew that dealing drugs would attract attention from the authorities, but it was a risk they were prepared to take. The U.S. Mafia secretly embraced the heroin trade and was soon making more money than they knew what to do with.
The unpleasant fact is that there is a new epidemic of heroin use in the United States.
As Sicilian heroin began to flow, addiction rates in America soared. At the end of World War II...
And that's a history, a legend of history. And so, you know, you pick a name, and I picked Donnie Brasco, and I picked a jewel thief, burglar, jewel thief, because it's a profession that is not involved in violence. You know, not many jewel thieves are in jail for murder. So you want a legend that is a non-violent legend, and you want one where you can provide somebody with something. So I could come around with precious gems, jewels, and tell them that I had just pulled a score.
Pistone's job was to work his way into a mafia family. The risks were great, but if he pulled it off, he had the chance to expose a secret world of crime. One wrong move, and he faced almost certain death.
In order to do this job, undercover work, you have to have two things. You gotta have a lot of nerve, and you gotta have a lot of mental toughness. I'm not a person that sweats, you know? When I get into a jam, I don't sweat, so you don't know if you're scaring me or not, you know? And, you know, there's not much that can be done to you. The worst thing that can happen is they can kill you. That's about it.
The FBI wanted the inside story on the mafia. The Bonanno boss, Carmine Galante, was their first target. Pistone used the FBI's diamonds and his Sicilian roots to gradually infiltrate Galante's mafia family.
Being of Italian ancestry and knowing the streets and knowing how the mafia operates, you know, you speak when you're spoken to. You mind your own business. You don't get involved in conversations that don't concern you. They don't just, you know, embrace you and take you in. And you have to just lay back, be patient, and work your way. You know, and it's the first impression that's gonna carry you through. And if you do things, certain things that they pick you out, that you have street smarts and you are a street guy, that's what's gonna make you.
The fuzzle was right on the table. It's like, it's ready to say that.
In March 1977, Pistone began to hang around in known Bonanno territory. He soon got noticed by mafia foot soldiers. One of the wise guys Pistone met was Lefty Ruggiero. Pistone would later discover that Lefty was a known hitman for the mob. Lefty approached Pistone, asking him to sell some stolen jewelry.
I was into dude.
And bring the American and Sicilian mafia to their knees.
FBI agent from a Sicilian background. His mission was to infiltrate the Mafia, something that had never been done before.
I grew up in New Jersey, and I grew up in an Italian neighborhood. And in this neighborhood, there were Mafia guys, mob guys, and I went to high school with sons of mob guys. So I knew about the Mafia growing up. It wasn't foreign to me when I became an FBI agent. So I was pretty well versed in the ways and traditions of the Mafia.
Joe Pistone's dream was always to be a cop.
Growing up, it would have been easy to go, you know, to go crooked or become bent because you're in the neighborhood, you see what's going on. There are guys doing illegal activities. But I never had an inkling to go toward that because of my parents. I mean, I know if I ever did anything wrong that I get a good swift boot in the rear end from my father.
On July the 7th, 1969, Pistone was sworn in as a special agent of the FBI. 7 years later, he disappeared from everyday life and developed a new identity.
Everybody needs a legend, and that's a history, a legend of history. And so, you know, you pick a name, and I picked Donnie Brasco, and I picked a jewel thief, burglar, jewel thief, because it's a profession that is not involved in violence. You know, not many jewel thieves are in jail for murder. So you want a legend that is a non-violent legend, and you want one where you can provide somebody with something. So I could come around with precious gems, jewels, and tell them that I had just pulled a score.
Pistone's job was to work his way into a Mafia family. The risks were great, but if he pulled it off, he had the chance to expose a secret world of crime. One wrong move, and he faced almost certain death.
In order to do this job, undercover work, you have to have two things. You gotta have a lot of nerve, and you gotta have a lot of mental toughness. I'm not a person that sweats, you know? When I get into a jam, I don't sweat, so you don't know if you're scaring me or not, you know? And, you know, there's not much that can be done to you. The worst thing that can happen is they can kill you. That's about it.
The FBI wanted the inside story on the Mafia. The Banano boss, Carmine Galante, was their first target. Pistone used the FBI's diamonds and his Sicilian roots to gradually infiltrate Galante's Mafia family.
Find intelligence that could only be found on the street. And that meant being out here, being the eyes and ears, basically, of the FBI, trying to determine who these Sicilians were and what they were doing.
One Banano member who soon came to their attention was Sal Catalano, who ran an Italian bakery in Queens. The FBI realized that Catalano was a key figure in the heroin trade. Suspicious packages were constantly being exchanged, probably containing either heroin or money. The FBI decided to play a waiting game in the hope they could break open the whole operation.
One of the things that we in the FBI, and of course all of law enforcement, wanted to know was how were they bringing the heroin into the United States at that time?
Over the next 5 years, Russo and Rooney's surveillance operation evolved into the largest investigation the FBI had ever undertaken. Finally, after recording and translating more than 55,000 wiretaps, the team of 400 agents worked out how the Mafia smuggled heroin into America.
They used their businesses, furniture businesses, construction businesses, marble, things of that nature. In particular, the pizzeria business. They needed tomatoes for the sauce.
The Mafia had taken over pizzerias across the country and given them to immigrant Sicilians to manage. The operation was controlled by Sal Catalano from his bakery in Queens.
This footage shows some of the actual restaurants implicated in the Pizza Connection trial. Restaurants just like these were used to distribute heroin around the country. The heroin arrived in the US through all kinds of routes. Their methods were often ingenious. Cases of canned tomatoes or boxes of cheese arrived from Sicily, stuffed with heroin worth hundreds of thousands of dollars. But the pizza network was not a retail operation. Mafia dealers never sold the heroin directly on the streets. Instead, the imported narcotics were divided up and sold to smaller street dealers. That way, the bosses stayed well away from the dirty end of the business. The pizza restaurants had another use as well. Catalano and his crew could hide their profits by passing them off as restaurant takings.
Pretty ingenious cover. I mean, you know, who figures a pizza place? You know, you figure you see some guy slinging a dough
over for his own protection.
The police deduced from what they saw at the scene that Bonventre and Amato were not there to protect Galante. They were there to ensure that his assassination was carried out without a hitch. The ultimate treachery was performed by his own men. The men who were supposed to protect him from any harm, they were the ones who actually helped carry out the assassination.
The Sicilians had turned on Galante. It seemed his greed had upset others besides the commission.
The Sicilians who had arrived in America in the 60s and 70s, who were helping bring in the heroin from Sicily, wanted full control in their hands. The message was, we are bringing it in, we are going to be involved in the distribution network. Therefore, we want a bigger share in the proceeds. And that was the message of the new Sicilians. We are the ones doing it, we want a bigger share. Not what Galante was doing, keeping most of the share for himself.
Galante's murder made the FBI even more suspicious about the Bonanno family. For the commission to whack a boss meant there were big things going on. Two young agents, Charlie Rooney and Carmine Russo, were given the job of watching the Bonanno Sicilians.
This is the area where myself and my partner, Charlie Rooney, spent a lot of time conducting surveillance. And we needed to find intelligence that could only be found on the street. And that meant being out here, being the eyes and ears, basically, of the FBI, trying to determine who these Sicilians were and what they were doing.
One Bonanno member, who soon came to their attention, was Sal Catalano, who ran an Italian bakery in Queens. The FBI realized that Catalano was a key figure in the heroin trade. Suspicious packages were constantly being exchanged, probably containing either heroin or money. The FBI decided to play a waiting game in the hope they could break open the whole operation.
One of the things that we in the FBI, and of course all of law enforcement, wanted to know was how were they bringing the heroin into the United States at that time?
Over the next 5 years, Russo and Rooney's surveillance operation evolved into the largest investigation the FBI had ever undertaken. Finally, after recording and translating more than 55,000 wiretaps, the team of 400 agents worked out how the Mafia smuggled heroin into America.
They used their businesses, furniture businesses.
Doing trade. But one of them was far more ambitious, far more greedy, and far more dangerous than the others. Totò Riina. Riina planned to shake up the Sicilian Mafia, just as Galante was making waves in America. The Sicilian Mafia always claimed they adhered to a code of honor, murdering only when necessary, and avoiding the killing of innocents, women and children. But Riina shunned these old guard rules. Riina was as ambitious as he was ruthless. He was determined to become the boss of bosses, head of the Sicilian Mafia. To achieve this, he would commit so many atrocities that he became known simply as the Beast. Totoriina, known as the Beast, was putting Sicily on the heroin map. In the early 70s, his factories were producing ton after ton of pure heroin. All of it needed to be sold. On the other side of the Atlantic, Carmine Galante and the American Mafia could see that there were huge sums to be made selling Sicilian heroin. But there was also a problem. Throughout its history, the US Mafia had vowed never to be associated with drugs. The Chicago mob, known as the Outfit, was one of the most vocal opponents of the drugs trade.
We always knew that if you dealt with drugs, it was a dirty business. And it'd be like you're feeding your own kid narcotics. So it was like taboo. And if you got involved with it, you're definitely gonna get whacked.
As far as the Outfit was concerned, there was no need to deal drugs when money could be made in more acceptable ways. In the 1970s, Frank Carlotta was sent to Las Vegas to make sure nobody messed with the Outfit's highly profitable casinos.
My main job was the casinos, to make sure that everything ran smooth in there, there was no stealing going on, that they knew that our presence was there, that if they did mess around, that they would get hit in the head.
For Carlotta and his crew, running casinos earned them respect in a way drugs never would.
Actually, it was great. It was beautiful. I mean, you had everything you needed out here. You had
Corina, the boss of the Colonese. Salvatore Catalano came here with a purpose. Purpose was the Sicilian Mafia had a commodity that was being sent to the United States. They needed people here whom they could trust and carry on that activity.
The power of the Colonese Mafia and their ruthless boss, Totoriina, stretched all the way to America.
Who knows how long they had been doing this before we stumbled onto them. And we basically stumbled onto them. And I believe what did it for them and for us was the Galante murder. Without that murder, I don't think we would have set our eyes on them at the time that we did.
Meanwhile, FBI agent Joe Pistone still had a problem. How to escape alive from his undercover role inside the Mafia. Despite Galante's murder, Joe Pistone's dangerous undercover operation continued for two more years. But in 1981, his mission came to a dramatic climax. The head of Pistone's Mafia crew was a hard man called Sonny Black. Over the years, Black had been impressed with Pistone. Now, Sonny decided to honor Pistone by making him a made man, a full member of the Mafia. But there was one big catch. Pistone would have to kill someone.
When Sonny Black gave me the contract to do the hit, I mean, you can't refuse it. You have to take the contract, otherwise you're the next guy that's gonna get killed, because, you know, that's just part of being a mob guy, a mafia guy, is that, because you don't do hits on a fee basis. You just do it because you're part of that crew. I accepted the hit. Luckily, the guy that I had the contract on was on the lam because he knew he was going to get killed. But I went looking for him. I went to Florida, back to New York, and couldn't find him because he was in hiding.
In a twist of fate, Pistone was asked to whack one of the men who had assassinated Carmine Galante. But it was not to be.
Hey.
The FBI could not allow an agent to commit murder. On July the 26th, 1981, Pistone was pulled out.
Did the kids ask about me?
The FBI decided to tell Pistone's mafia contacts that he was an undercover agent. Despite Galante's murder, Joe Pistone's dangerous undercover operation continued for two more years. But in 1981, his mission came to a dramatic climax. back in 1931. This was like the board of directors of the Mafia. All the heads of the families would meet to settle disputes and decide on strategy. The commission imposed discipline on the warring families. Rules were agreed, which changed little over decades. One of the rules was that you didn't kill someone without permission from the head of your family. Las Vegas mobster Frank Carlotta nearly paid the ultimate price when this rule was broken, thanks to his ruthless boss, Tony Spilotro.
I grew up with this Tony guy. He was a very good friend. And as I said, you know, very good friends that are ones that are going to get you killed. And when he had ordered me to whack some guy out here, I asked him, did you get the okay from back home? And he said, yeah. And he promised me he did. Well, he never did get the okay from home. And he got a call from one of the bosses back there, and they said, what are you guys doing out there?
Killing someone without authorization from Chicago was breaking the rules. The punishment was death. Tony Spilotro decided to blame his best friend, Frank Carlotta.
He was lying. He was taking the weight off himself because he knew that if he didn't, and said he readily ordered me to do these things, that they would whack him in the head. So he shifted everything over to me. That was my best friend. We shined shoes together when we were 12, 13 years old. So all my life. He's the guy that actually was the guy that told me, when I get to be a big man, you're my right-hand man. And I was. But that's the same guy that was gonna sell me out to save his ass and get me whacked.
It wasn't long before Tony Spilotro and his mobster brother received deadly punishment at the hands of the mob.
Believe it or not, I felt a little bad for him. Because they were both beaten to death. They weren't shot, they weren't strangled, they were
living the way I live, and if it happens, it happens, and the best man will win.
Thanks to the efforts of law enforcement agents like Joe Pistone and Carmine Russo, the Pizza Connection investigation seriously weakened the American Mafia. After years of making vast profits from narcotics, it would take much more than that to stop them. Well, nobody messed with the outfit's highly profitable casinos.
My main job was the casinos, to make sure that everything ran smooth in there, there was no stealing going on, that they knew that our presence was there, that if they did mess around, that they would get hit in the head.
For Carlotta and his crew, running casinos earned them respect in a way drugs never would.
Actually, it was great. It was beautiful. I mean, you had everything you needed out here. You had anything you wanted to do. Movie stars. They wanted to be involved with you. You wanted to be involved with them. Anywhere you went, you got the red carpet treatment. It was like, you were respected. I think you were respected. I'm hoping that I wasn't feared, but in some cases you were feared. And if that brought respect, well, then it brought respect.
But for others, the huge profits of heroin dealing were hard to resist. From his beginnings in suburban Brooklyn, Dominic Montilio grew up to be a member of the notorious New York crime family, the Gambinos. He dealt drugs for the Mafia for many years.
The word that filtered down, just saying, you know, if you got caught, you know, dealing drugs, you know, it was an immediate death sentence. But the real message that came down was just don't get caught. At that time, I couldn't think of one crew that I knew that wasn't involved in it, because the money was too lucrative to pass up. The street crews that were involved in it weren't going to give it up either which way. You know, there was guys that weren't making a real good living that all of a sudden were taking, you know, 150 large a week down.
The mob didn't want to be seen to be peddling drugs, but they were happy to take the money.
I mean, the reason there was no great moral reasons why they didn't want you dealing in heroin, it was just that it would bring that much more heat on the family. But the bottom line is the cash, you know, and that's cash business. And the amounts are staggering, the amounts of money that can be made.
The New York families knew that dealing drugs would attract attention from the authorities, but it was a risk they were prepared to take. The U.S. Mafia secretly embraced the heroin trade and were soon making more money than they knew what to do with.
The unpleasant fact is that there is a new epidemic of heroin use in the United States.
As Sicilian heroin began to flow, addiction rates in America soared. At the end of World War II, America had an estimated 20...
Where the power came from. It was Salvatore Riina, the boss of the Corleonesi. Salvatore Catalano came here with a purpose. Purpose was the Sicilian Mafia had a commodity that was being sent to the United States. They needed people here whom they could trust and carry on that activity.
The power of the Corleonesi Mafia and their ruthless boss, Totore Riina, stretched all the way to America.
Who knows how long they had been doing this before we stumbled onto them. And we basically stumbled onto them. And I believe what did it for them and for us was the Galante murder. Without that murder, I don't think we would have set our eyes on them at the time that we did.
Meanwhile, FBI agent Joe Pistone still had a problem. How to escape alive from his undercover role inside the Mafia. Despite Galante's murder, Joe Pistone's dangerous undercover operation continued for two more years. But in 1981, his mission came to a dramatic climax. The head of Pistone's Mafia crew was a hard man called Sonny Black. Over the years, Black had been impressed with Pistone. Now, Sonny decided to honor Pistone by making him a made man, a full member of the Mafia. But there was one big catch. Pistone would have to kill someone.
When Sonny Black gave me the contract to do the hit, I mean, you can't refuse it. You have to take the contract, otherwise you're the next guy that's gonna get killed, because, you know, that's just part of being a mob guy, a Mafia guy, is that, because you don't do hits on a fee basis. You just do it because you're part of the you're part of that crew. I accepted the hit. Luckily, the guy that I had the contract on was on the lam because he knew he was going to get killed. But I went looking for him. I went to Florida, back to New York, and couldn't find him because he was in hiding.
In a twist of fate, Pistone was asked to whack one of the men who had assassinated Carmine Galante. But it was not to be.
Hey.
The FBI could not allow an agent to commit murder. On July the 26th, 1981, Pistone was pulled out.
Did the kids ask about me?
The FBI decided to tell Pistone's Mafia contacts that he was an undercover agent. Despite Galante's murder, Joe Pistone's dangerous undercover operation continued for two more years. But in 1981...
The message that came down was just don't get caught. At that time, I couldn't think of one crew that I knew that wasn't involved in it, because the money was too lucrative to pass up. The street crews that were involved in it weren't going to give it up either which way. You know, there was guys that weren't making a real good living that all of a sudden were taking, you know, 150 large a week down.
The mob didn't want to be seen to be peddling drugs, but they were happy to take the money.
I mean, the reason, there was no great moral reasons why they didn't want you dealing in heroin. It was just that it would bring that much more heat on the family. But the bottom line is the cash. You know, and that's cash business. And the amounts are staggering, the amounts of money that can be made.
The New York families knew that dealing drugs would attract attention from the authorities, but it was a risk they were prepared to take. The US Mafia secretly embraced the heroin trade and were soon making more money than they knew what to do with.
The unpleasant fact is that there is a new epidemic of heroin use in the United States.
As Sicilian heroin began to flow, addiction rates in America soared. At the end of World War II, America had an estimated 20,000 heroin users. By the mid-70s, there were more than 500,000. The FBI had little idea how such large quantities of drugs were getting into the country, or who was bringing it in. But that was about to change. In the 50s and 60s, FBI agents were mostly white males. Now the FBI was recruiting from a much wider pool. Finally, they had young, ambitious agents who came from the communities that were home to the Mafia and could speak the Sicilian dialect. Joe Pistone was a young FBI agent from a Sicilian background. His mission was to infiltrate the Mafia, something that had never been done before.
I grew up in New Jersey, and I grew up in an Italian neighborhood. In this neighborhood, there were Mafia guys, mob guys, and I went to high school with sons of mob guys. So I knew about the Mafia growing up. It wasn't foreign to me when I became an FBI agent. So I was pretty well versed in the ways and traditions of the Mafia.
Joe Pistone's dream was always to be a cop.
Growing up, it was easy. It would have been easy to go, you know,
money. The FBI decided to play a waiting game in the hope they could break open the whole operation.
One of the things that we in the FBI, and of course all of law enforcement, wanted to know was how were they bringing the heroin into the United States at that time?
Over the next 5 years, Russo and Rooney's surveillance operation evolved into the largest investigation the FBI had ever undertaken. Finally, after recording and translating more than 55,000 wiretaps, the team of 400 agents worked out how the Mafia smuggled heroin into America.
They used their businesses, furniture businesses.
Doing trade. But one of them was far more ambitious, far more greedy, and far more dangerous than the others. Totò Riina. Riina planned to shake up the Sicilian Mafia, just as Galante was making waves in America. The Sicilian Mafia always claimed they adhered to a code of honor, murdering only when necessary, and avoiding the killing of innocents, women and children. But Riina shunned these old guard rules. Riina was as ambitious as he was ruthless. He was determined to become the boss of bosses, head of the Sicilian Mafia. To achieve this, he would commit so many atrocities that he became known simply as the Beast. Totò Riina, known as the Beast, was putting Sicily on the heroin map. In the early 70s, his factories were producing ton after ton of pure heroin. All of it needed to be sold. On the other side of the Atlantic, Carmine Galante and the American Mafia could see that there were huge sums to be made selling Sicilian heroin. But there was also a problem. Throughout its history, the U.S. Mafia had vowed never to be associated with drugs. The Chicago mob, known as the Outfit, was one of the most vocal opponents of the drugs trade.
We always knew that if you dealt with drugs, it was a dirty business. And it'd be like you're feeding your own kid narcotics. So it was like taboo. And if you got involved with it, you're definitely going to get wet.
In the early 70s, his factories were producing ton after ton of pure heroin. All of it needed to be sold. On the other side of the Atlantic, Carmine Galante and the American Mafia could see that there were huge sums to be made selling Sicilian heroin. But there was also a problem. Throughout its history, the US Mafia had vowed never to be associated with drugs. The Chicago mob, known as the Outfit, was one of the most vocal opponents of the drugs trade.
We always knew that if you dealt with drugs, it was a dirty business. And it'd be like you're feeding your own kid narcotics. So it was like taboo. And if you got involved with it, you're definitely going to get whacked.
As far as the Outfit was concerned, there was no need to deal drugs when money could be made in more acceptable ways. In the 1970s, Frank Calotta was sent to Las Vegas to make sure nobody messed with the Outfit's highly profitable casinos.
My main job was the casinos, to make sure that everything ran smooth in there, there was no stealing going on, that they knew that our presence was there, that if they did mess around, that they would get hit in the head.
For Calotta and his crew, running casinos earned them respect in a way drugs never would.
Actually, it was great. It was beautiful. I mean, you had everything you needed out here. You had
Riina, the boss of the Colonese. Salvatore Catalano came here with a purpose. Purpose was the Sicilian Mafia had a commodity that was being sent to the United States. They needed people here whom they could trust. and carry on that activity.
The power of the Corleonese Mafia and their ruthless boss, Totorina, stretched all the way to America.
Who knows how long they had been doing this before we stumbled onto them. And we basically stumbled onto them. And I believe what did it for them and for us was the Galante murder. Without that murder, I don't think we would have set our eyes on them at the time that we did.
Meanwhile, FBI agent Joe Pistone still had a problem. How to escape alive from his undercover role inside the Mafia. Despite Galante's murder, Joe Pistone's dangerous undercover operation continued for two more years. But in 1981, his mission came to a dramatic climax. The head of Pistone's Mafia crew was agreed and upset others besides the commission.
The Sicilians who had arrived in America in the 60s and 70s, who were helping bring in the heroin from Sicily, wanted full control in their hands. The message was, we are bringing it in, we are going to be involved in the distribution network. Therefore, we want a bigger share in the proceeds. And that was the message of the new Sicilians. We are the ones doing it, we want a bigger share. Not what Galante was doing, keeping most of the share for himself.
Galante's murder made the FBI even more suspicious about the Bonanno family. For the commission to whack a boss meant there were big things going on. Two young agents, Charlie Rooney and Carmine Russo, were given the job of watching the Bonanno Sicilians.
This is the area where myself and my partner, Charlie Rooney, spent a lot of time conducting surveillance. And we needed to find intelligence that could only be found on the street. And that meant being out here, being the eyes and ears, basically, of the FBI, trying to determine who these Sicilians were and what they were doing.
One Bonanno member, who soon came to their attention, was Sal Catalano, who ran an Italian bakery in Queens. The FBI realized that Catalano was a key figure in the heroin trade. Suspicious packages were constantly being exchanged, probably containing either heroin or money. The FBI decided to play a waiting game in the hope they could break open the whole operation.
One of the things that we in the FBI, and of course all of law enforcement, wanted to know was how were they bringing the heroin into the United States at that time?
Over the next 5 years, Russo and Rooney's surveillance operation evolved into the largest investigation the FBI had ever undertaken. Finally, after recording and translating more than 55,000 wiretaps, the team of 400 agents worked out how the Mafia smuggled heroin into America.
They used their businesses, furniture businesses, construction businesses, marble, things of that nature. In particular, the pizzeria business. They needed tomatoes for the sauce.
The Mafia had taken over pizzerias across the country and given them to immigrant Sicilians to manage. The operation was controlled by Sal Catalano from his bakery in Queens. This footage shows some of the actual restaurants implicated in the Pizza Connection trial.
office rocker, and always known as a heroin man. That's what he did.
When Galante got out of prison, the Bananos were in crisis. Their leadership either exiled or in prison. Joe Bonanno's son, Bill, is a convicted mobster. He remembers Galante only too well.
He had a short fuse. He was abrasive. He had a manner about him that he would never win any popularity contest. And constantly had a cigar in his mouth. And that's where he got his nickname, the Cigar.
With no challengers prepared to take on this dangerous man, the Bananos had their new boss. Galante's top priority was to kickstart the heroin trade. In 5 short years, he transformed the fortunes of the US Mafia by leading it into an era of multi-billion dollar profits and unparalleled violence.
In the 70s, the Bonanno family was known in the Mafia circles basically as being the heroin family. I mean, you know, everybody knew they were dealing in heroin.
Galante was now in the perfect position to build a heroin business even bigger than the French Connection. He was head of the Bonanno family, and now the heroin trade was moving to Sicily, where Galante had his roots. Galante was born in New York, but his family came from the town of Castellammare del Golfo in the northwest of Sicily. Sicilians had been emigrating to America for 100 years, but many of their descendants kept strong links with their homeland. Galante was no exception. His plan was to exploit his close ties with the Sicilian mafia to dominate the American heroin trade. This was the beginning of a whole new era in the history of the Mafia. Until now, the Sicilian and American Mafia had mainly operated as separate organizations. With the French Connection broken, the Sicilian Mafia decided to fill the gap in the market, and there was no bigger market than America. The Sicilians set up a sophisticated smuggling system. Pakistani suppliers shipped partially refined opium from Asia via Turkey to a rendezvous point off the coast of Sicily. A transmitter on the seabed alerted the Sicilians. Their solution would be violent. Galante had to go. On July the 12th, 1979, Carmine Galante paid a visit to Joe and Mary's restaurant on Knickerbocker Avenue in Brooklyn. It was one of his favorite haunts. Run by his cousin, he felt safe there. He was joined by his 2 loyal Sicilian bodyguards.
There's a courtyard that you go into, and is an open-air courtyard. And they were sitting down getting ready to have lunch. And Galante was sitting there, and he had his cigar in his mouth. Three guys pull up outside, jump out of a car. They run in the restaurant and start blasting away. Galante ends up getting shot, falls off his chair, sprawls out on the ground, face up, and he still has his cigar clenched in his mouth. And that's how they got Galante.
This is the famous front page that greeted America the next morning. Galante's meteoric rise to the top had ended in a pool of blood.
Carmine Galante was rubbed out today as he sat in a Brooklyn luncheonette, a gangland execution of a man believed to be the most important organized crime figure in the country.
After the murder, the killers fled the scene. But in an amazing coincidence, one of them walked into a club that was under police surveillance. This incredible footage shows him reporting back to the commission bosses after the successful hit. But the feds were about to get an even bigger surprise.
Well, when the police came on the scene, they had immediately identified Carmine Galante's body. He was an old man, had a cigar stuck in his mouth, totally lifeless. As the police pieced everything together, they were told that two other individuals who were in the backyard with Galante, later identified as his so-called bodyguards, they were the ones who miraculously got out of there without any wounds whatsoever.
Forensics found five different caliber slugs in Galante, and there were only three gunmen. So that leads you to believe that there were two guns someplace else. And the only other...
The opium base was processed into heroin in laboratories on the west of the island. Three Sicilian bosses ran this growing trade, but one of them was far more ambitious, far more greedy, and far more dangerous than the others. Dottor Riina. Riina planned to shake up the Sicilian mafia, just as Galante was making waves in America. The Sicilian mafia always claimed they adhered to a code of honor, murdering only when necessary, and avoiding the killing of innocents, women and children. But Riina shunned these old guard rules. Riina was as ambitious as he was ruthless. He was determined to become the boss of bosses, head of the Sicilian mafia. To achieve this, he would commit so many atrocities that he became known simply as the Beast. Dottor Riina, known as the Beast, was putting Sicily on the heroin map. In the early 70s, his factories were producing ton after ton of pure heroin. All of it needed to be sold. On the other side of the Atlantic, Carmine Galante and the American mafia could see that there were huge sums to be made selling Sicilian heroin. But there was also a problem. Throughout its history, the US mafia had vowed never to be associated with drugs. The Chicago mob, known as the Outfit, was one of the most vocal opponents of the drugs trade.
We always knew that if you dealt with drugs, it was a dirty business. And it'd be like you're feeding your own kid narcotics. So it was like taboo. And if you got involved with it, you're definitely gonna get whacked.
As far as the Outfit was concerned, there was no need to deal drugs when money could be made in more acceptable ways. In the 1970s, Frank Carlotta was sent to Las Vegas to make sure nobody messed with the Outfit's highly profitable casinos.
My main job was the casinos, to make sure that everything ran smooth in there, there was no stealing going on, that they knew that our presence was there, that if they did mess around, that they would get hit in the head.
For Carlotta and his crew, running casinos earned them respect in a way.
Weren't you dealing in heroin? It was just that it would bring that much more heat on the family. But the bottom line is the cash, you know, and that's a cash business. And the amounts are staggering, the amounts of money that can be made.
The New York families knew that dealing drugs would attract attention from the authorities, but it was a risk they were prepared to take. The US mafia secretly embraced the heroin trade and was soon making more money than they knew what to do with.
The unpleasant fact is that there is a new epidemic of heroin use in the United States.
As Sicilian heroin began to flow, addiction rates in America soared. At the end of World War II, America had an estimated 20,000 heroin users. By the mid-70s, there were more than 500,000. The FBI had little idea how such large quantities of drugs were getting into the country,
or who was bringing it in. But that was about to change. In the 50s and 60s, FBI agents were mostly white males. Now the FBI was recruiting from a much wider pool. Finally, they had young, ambitious agents who came from the communities that were home to the Mafia and could speak the Sicilian dialect. Joe Pistone was a young FBI agent from a Sicilian background. His mission was to infiltrate the Mafia, something that had never been done before.
I grew up in New Jersey, and I grew up in an Italian neighborhood. And in this neighborhood, there were Mafia guys, mob guys, and I went to high school with sons of mob guys. So I knew about the Mafia growing up. It wasn't foreign to me when I became an FBI agent. So I was pretty well versed in the ways and traditions of the Mafia.
Joe Pistone's dream was always to be a cop.
Growing up, it would have been easy to go, you know, to go crooked or become bent because you're in the neighborhood, you see what's going on. There are guys doing illegal activities. But I never had an inkling to go toward that because of my parents. I mean, I know if I ever did anything wrong that I get a good swift boot in the rear end from my father.
On July the 7th, 1969, Pistone was sworn in as a special agent of the FBI. 7 years later, he disappeared from everyday life and developed a new identity.
Everybody needs a legend, and that's a history, a legend.
A year. Galante was trying to keep the profits to himself. Something had to be done.
He was greedy. He wasn't, you know, the Bananos may have been involved in the profits from this drug trade, but Galante wasn't sharing it even with his own people and the family. Because he was, and nobody was going to tell him what to do, and he was going to run his family, and he wanted to run the other families too. And during this time, Galante was making deadly enemies. The other bosses didn't like him because of this attitude that he had, that he was the top boss in the city.
Everyone knew on the street that the clouds of war were right there. I mean, if this guy stayed loose, what he was plotting would have definitely caused major, you know, war to happen between the families.
For mob bosses, the Galante problem was growing. Only the commission had the authority to act. Their solution would be violent. Galante had to go. On July the 12th, 1979, Carmine Galante paid a visit to Joe and Mary's restaurant on Knickerbocker Avenue in Brooklyn. It was one of his favorite haunts. Run by his cousin, he felt safe there. He was joined by his two loyal Sicilian bodyguards.
There's a courtyard that you go into, and is an open-air courtyard. And they were sitting down getting ready to have lunch. And Galante was sitting there and he had his cigar in his mouth. Three guys pull up outside, jump out of a car. They run in the restaurant and start blasting away. Galante ends up getting shot, falls off his chair, sprawls out on the ground, face up, and he still has his cigar clenched in his mouth. And that's how they got Galante.
This is the famous front page that greeted America the next morning. Galante's meteoric rise to the top had ended in a pool of blood.
Carmine Galante was rubbed out today as he sat in a Brooklyn luncheonette, a gang.
One of the rules was that you didn't kill someone without permission from the head of your family. Las Vegas mobster Frank Carlotta nearly paid the ultimate price when this rule was broken, thanks to his ruthless boss, Tony Spilotro.
I grew up with this Tony guy. He was a very good friend. And as I said, you know, very good friends that are ones that are going to get you killed. And when he had ordered me to whack some guy out here, I asked him, did you get the okay from back home? And he said, yeah. And he promised me he did. Well, he never did get the okay from home. And he got a call from one of the bosses back there, and they said, what are you guys doing out there?
Killing someone without authorization from Chicago was breaking the rules. The punishment was death. Tony Spilotro decided to blame his best friend, Frank Carlotta.
He was lying. He was taking the weight off himself because he knew that if he didn't, and said he readily ordered me to do these things, that they would whack him in the head. So he shifted everything over to me. That was my best friend. We shined shoes together when we were 12, 13 years old. So all my life. He's the guy that actually was the guy that told me, when I get to be a big man, you're my right-hand man. And I was. But that's the same guy that was gonna sell me out to save his ass and get me whacked.
It wasn't long before Tony Spilotro and his mobster brother received deadly punishment at the hands of the mob.
Believe it or not, I felt a little bad for him. They were both beaten to death. They weren't shot, they weren't strangled, they were
living the way I live, and if it happens, it happens, and the best man will win.
Thanks to the efforts of law enforcement agents like Joe Pistone and Carmine Russo, the Pizza Connection investigation seriously weakened the American Mafia. After years of making vast profits from narcotics, it would take much more than that to stop them. No one could have foreseen that in the coming years, the actions of one Mafia boss would change everything and bring the American and Sicilian Mafia to their knees. Joe Pistone was a young FBI agent from a Sicilian background. His mission was to infiltrate the Mafia, something that had never been done before.
I grew up in New Jersey, and I grew up in an Italian neighborhood. And in this neighborhood, there were mafia guys, mob guys, and I went to high school with sons of mob guys. So I knew about the mafia growing up. It wasn't foreign to me when I became an FBI agent. So I was pretty well versed in the ways and traditions of the mafia.
Joe Pistone's dream was always to be a cop.
Growing up, it was easy, it would have been easy to go, you know, to go crooked or become bent because you're in the neighborhood, you see what's going on. There are guys doing illegal activities. But I never had an inkling to go toward that because of my parents. I mean, I know if I ever did anything wrong that I get a good swift boot in the rear end from my father.
On July the 7th, 1969, Pistone was sworn in as a special agent of the FBI. 7 years later, he disappeared from everyday life and developed a new identity.
Everybody needs a legend, and that's a history, a legend, a history. And so, you know, you pick a name, and I picked Donnie Brasco, and I picked a jewel thief, burglar, jewel thief, because it's a profession that is not involved in violence. You know, not many jewel thieves are in jail for murder. So you want a legend that is a non-violent legend, and you want one where you can provide somebody with something. So I could come around with precious gems, jewels, and tell them that I had just pulled a score.
Pistone's job was to work his way into a Mafia family. The risks were great, but if he pulled it off, he had the chance to expose a secret world of crime. One wrong move, and he faced almost certain death.
In order to do this job, undercover work, you have to have two things. You gotta have a lot of nerve, and you gotta have a lot of mental toughness. I'm not a person that sweats, you know? When I get into a jam, I don't sweat, so you don't know if you're scaring me or not, you know? And, you know, there's not much that can be done to you. The worst thing that can happen is they can kill you. That's about it.
The FBI wanted the inside story on the Mafia. The Bonanno boss, Carmine Galante, was their first target. Pistone used the FBI's diamonds and Totorina, known as the Beast, was putting Sicily on the heroin map. In the early 70s, his factories were producing ton after ton of pure heroin. All of it needed to be sold. On the other side of the Atlantic, Carmine Galante and the American Mafia could see that there were huge sums to be made selling Sicilian heroin. But there was also a problem. Throughout its history, the US Mafia had vowed never to be associated with drugs. The Chicago mob, known as the Outfit, was one of the most vocal opponents of the drugs trade.
We always knew that if you dealt with drugs, it was a dirty business. And it'd be like you're feeding your own kid narcotics. So it was like taboo. And if you got involved with it, you're definitely gonna get whacked.
As far as the Outfit was concerned, there was no need to deal drugs when money could be made in more acceptable ways. In the 1970s, Frank Calotta was sent to Las Vegas to make sure nobody messed with the Outfit's highly profitable casinos.
My main job was the casinos, to make sure that everything ran smooth in there, there was no stealing going on, that they knew that our presence was there, that if they did mess around, that they would get hit in the head.
For Calotta and his crew, running casinos earned them respect in a way drugs never would.
Actually, it was great. It was beautiful. I mean, you had everything you needed out here. You had
Corina, the boss of the Colonese. Salvatore Catalano came here with a purpose. Purpose was the Sicilian Mafia had a commodity that was being sent to the United States. They needed people here whom they could trust and carry on that activity.
The power of the Colonese Mafia and their ruthless boss, Totorina, stretched all the way to America.
Who knows how long they had been doing this before we stumbled onto them. And we basically stumbled onto them. And I believe what did it for them and for us was the Galante murder. Without that murder, I don't think we would have set our eyes on them at the time that we did.
Meanwhile, FBI agent Joe Pistone still had a problem. How to escape alive from his undercover role inside the Mafia. Despite Galante's murder, Joe Pistone's dangerous undercover operation continued to rise within the New York Mafia.
Joe came back to us telling us about Sicilians whom the American Mafia figures were referring to as Zips. And to him, this meant that these Sicilian Mafia figures within the Bonanno family were actually being used to commit murder, dealing in drugs, heroin. That was just unbelievable revelation.
I met some Sicilian that were members of the Mafia. And these guys were made guys over in Sicily and then brought over here. But the Sicilians had their own clique over here in the U.S.
Galante had imported his own private army of ruthless Sicilian mafiosi.
Galante's two key guys that he brought over were Cesar Bonaventure and Baldo Amato. He brought them over from Sicily, and they were with him constantly. And I think one of the reasons why he did bring him over is that he felt a better sense of security with the Sicilians, because I guess he felt they were still loyal to the tradition. They weren't Americanized yet.
Galante's new bodyguards made waves in the Bonanno family.
There was a lot of friction, I found, between the American Mafia and the Sicilians, even though they were married up into one family. I mean, anyway, Lefty and Sonny and the other Americans thought that they were looking to take over the family, and that the other American Mafia guys didn't trust them and didn't like them.
The Sicilian and American Mafia were cut from very different cloth. In the past, the Sicilians had embraced rules and traditions, but that was changing.
They'd kill anyone, you know, where we had certain rules. You know, it sounds strange, but there were rules as to, you know, who you had to get permission from to go do a piece of work, or you couldn't kill a guy in front of his family, and, you know, they didn't have those rules.
These new, ruthless Sicilians were from a mafia clan based in Corleone, a remote rural town deep in the mountains of Sicily. Corleone mafiosi are made of different stuff. They're tough, very hard. Probably their peasant lifestyle trained them to withstand anything thrown at them. Had reached the top of the Sicilian Mafia by breaking rules and killing without permission from anyone. In the American Mafia, obedience to your superiors was deeply ingrained. The godfather of the American Mafia, Charlie Lucky Luciano, had formed an organization known as the Commission back in 1931. This was like the board of directors of the Mafia. All the heads of the families would meet to settle disputes and decide on strategy. The commission imposed discipline on the warring families. Rules were agreed, which changed little over decades. One of the rules was that you didn't kill someone without permission from the head of your family. Las Vegas mobster Frank Carlotta nearly paid the ultimate price when this rule was broken, thanks to his ruthless boss, Tony Spilotro.
I grew up with this Tony guy. He was a very good friend. And as I said, you know, very good friends that are ones that are gonna get you killed. And when he had ordered me to whack some guy out here, I asked him, did you get the okay from back home? And he said, yeah. And he promised me he did. Well, he never did get the okay from home. And he got a call from one of the bosses back there, and they said, what are you guys doing out there?
Killing someone without authorization from Chicago was breaking the rules. The punishment was death. Tony Spilotro decided to blame his best friend, Frank Carlotta.
He was lying. He was taking the weight off himself, because he knew that if he didn't, and said he readily ordered me to do these things, that they would whack him in the head. So he shifted everything over to me. That was my best friend. We shined shoes together when we were 12, 13 years old.
The hit Luckily, the guy that I had the contract on was on the lam because he knew he was going to get killed. But I went looking for him. I went to Florida, back to New York, and couldn't find him because he was in hiding.
In a twist of fate, Pistone was asked to whack one of the men who had assassinated Carmine Galante. But it was not to be.
Hey.
The FBI could not allow an agent to commit murder. On July the 26th, 1981, Pistone was pulled out.
Did the kids ask about me?
The FBI decided to tell Pistone's mafia contacts that he was an undercover agent. Despite Galante's murder, Joe Pistone's dangerous undercover operation continued for two more years. But in 1981, his mission came to a dramatic climax.